Welcome to Smart Catalyst, 16th November 2018. These are the topics we are going to discuss for prelims today. First one is Supreme Court pulls up states for delay in recruitment of judges. The next is 13th East Asia Summit in Singapore. The next is India-China agree to expand military ties. National Mission for Clean Ganga. Mega Food Park in Aurangabad District. Supreme Court pulls up states for delay in the recruitment of judges. Supreme Court has recently questioned the state governments and the administrative side of the high courts. This is because there is a delay in filling in the vacancies in the subordinate judicial services. This is because there is more than 2.5 crore cases pending in these subordinate courts. This is actually amplified because there is also a vacancy in the courts. More than 22,036 posts are vacant in the subordinate courts. Especially in states like Uttar Pradesh, West Bengal and Delhi, there is inefficiency and inordinate delay in filling up these vacancies. But what is the reason for vacancies? It is because poor infrastructure and lackadaisical approach, which is lethargic approach in the appointment process. So we know what are all the problems relating to the vacancies. So how to rectify them? First, we should fill up the vacancies by following an active process, and next we should provide adequate infrastructure to give space for the judiciary to function properly. 13th East Asia Summit in Singapore. So what is the news is that there is 13th East Asia Summit held at Singapore, in which our Prime Minister called for enhancing multilateral cooperation and economic and cultural ties. Also, he assured that India was committed to a peaceful and prosperous Indo-Pacific region. We should know what is East Asia Summit. Before that, we'll know what are all the countries present in that. First is 10 ASEAN nations plus 6 countries in Asia-Pacific, which is together called as RCEP. Along which Russia and US joined this RCEP in the 6th East Asia Summit in 2011. This RCEP is having half of the world population and third of its GDP. So what is the objective of East Asia Summit is that regional peace, security and prosperity. So East Asia Summit Forum is held annually by leaders of 18 countries, which is mentioned here. And this is established in the year 2005. This is the initiative of an ASEAN, which is based on the premise of centrality of ASEAN. From the prelims point of view, we should know that India is the founding member of East Asia Summit. So India-China has agreed to expand their military ties and enhance interaction to ensure peace. The animosity between India and China started with the Indo-China War fought in 1962. But after that, it was rectified by various actions. But it reached its peak in the recent Doklam standoff in the Himalayan border, which is 73-day military face-off. Despite these differences, in Wuhan summit, both the country leaders decided to initiate the peace processes. The recent meeting between the defense minister is the continuation of the Wuhan summit. So what are all the objective of these recent meeting is that they are trying to strengthen the ties by conducting various training programs, joint exercises and other professional interaction. And they also decided to implement confidence building measures to ensure the maintenance of peace, including the early operational of hotline between the armed forces. The next topic is National Mission for Clean Ganga. So National Mission for Clean Ganga is an implementation wing for National Council for Rejuvenation, Protection and Management of River Ganga, which is referred as National Ganga Council. This was called as National Ganga River Basin Authority, which was called as National Ganga before 2016. National Mission for Clean Ganga works to take measures for the prevention, control and abatement of environmental pollution in River Ganga. To implement this mission, in 2015, they signed a Memorandum of Understanding with National Remote Sensing Center, NRC, in June 2015. By this, they have brought two initiatives, which is Bhuvan Ganga Geo Portal and Bhuvan Ganga Mobile Applications. These two initiatives are available for water quality monitoring, hydrological monitoring, geomorphological monitoring, bioresource monitoring and also comprehensive geospatial database. Next, we are going to see about Mega Food Park in Aurangabad. This scheme is under the Ministry of Food Processing. The main aim of the scheme is to link the agricultural production to the market by bringing the stakeholders like farmers, processors and retailers together. This scheme works based on the cluster approach. which is explained here. Now this mega food part collects the products from individual farmers, farmer groups and self-help groups. Now they process these food products and separate it as value-added products and fresh products. These value-added products are either exported or taken for domestic sales. These fresh products are taken for domestic sales. So what are all the benefits from this scheme? This ensures maximizing value addition, minimizing wastage, increasing farmers' income and creating employment opportunities, particularly in the rural sector. This mega food park can be established by the formation of special purpose vehicle, which is formed by farmer producer companies. State government entities and cooperatives. Next, we have five topics for the discussion for mains. And first comes a concept of Indo-Pacific democracies. Next is the tackling India's open defecation problem. RBI and government, who are stepping back from the brink. Next is when judges legislate. The last one comes another orbit on which GSAT-29 launch. A concept of Indo-Pacific democracies. US is advocating for a free and open Indo-Pacific region without authoritarianism and aggression. To bring this free and open Indo-Pacific region a reality, every country has to participate, in which Japan is having the ability to realize this vision. First time the term free and open Indo-Pacific is termed by Shinzo Abe, the Prime Minister of Japan. As a response to the China's muscular rise, Japan is willing to participate in the ASEAN security. This is making Japan an important player in this region. Natural alliance between the richest democracy, which is Japan, and the largest democracy in this region, India, is very crucial, because the strong India benefits Japan and the strong Japan benefits India. This is known by the recent summit in which India and Japan has signed the Military Logistics Pact. Along with this 2+2 dialogue, naval and maritime security cooperation and the developmental projects in third countries are implemented by both the countries. In this summit, they have given a new motto for the bilateral relationship, which is shared security, shared prosperity and shared destiny. This Malabar exercise, which is between India, Japan and USA, is having an important component of effort to defend freedom of navigation and overflight in the Indo-Pacific region. This is very crucial because 2/3 of the global trade takes place in this Indo-Pacific region. To make this free and open Indo-Pacific region, the relationship between Indo-Pacific's four key maritime democracies, which is United States of America, India, Japan and Australia, should be made stronger. For the proper functioning of this Quad, a deepened relationship between the India-Japan dyad is important. This concept of Indo-Pacific democracies is not easy because there are certain challenges like Japan's rancorous relationship with South Korea and domestic instability in key countries. To stall the emergence of China-centric Asia, the deepening relationship between Japan and India is very important. The next topic is tackling India's open defecation problem. Open defecation is a serious health issue in India. This is curtailed through Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, which is a nationwide campaign in India which started in 2014. This open defecation issue is curtailed by following these objectives like eliminating open defecation, construction of household and community-owned toilets, and also establishing an accountable mechanism of monitoring toilet use. According to Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation, open defecation free is termination of fecal oral transmission. This is defined by there should be no feces found in environment and village, and every household as well as public or community institution should have a safe technology option for disposable of feces. What is a safe technology option? This means there should not be any contamination of surface soil, groundwater or surface water, and the excreta should be inaccessible to flies or animals. And fresh excreta should not be handled by human beings, and freedom from odor and unsightly conditions should also be achieved. This infographic shows us the drastic development achieved by India after the initiation of Swachh Bharat mission till date. To tackle this India's open defecation problems, these two drivers has to be followed to initiate behavioral changes in the Indians. To make India an open defecation free country, these three pillars of support is required. First is to provide a proper infrastructure and toilet for the public use. Second one is to motivate people to change behavior towards the toilet. Third one is harness cues and automatic habits to drive positive behavior. RBI and the government stepping back from the brink. There is a tension between the central bank and finance ministry which is not new to the India. These tensions are due to the different roles played by these institutions which are controversial at some instances. So what are all the roles of these institutions? First, the central banks are primarily responsible for the monetary policy and maintaining a low rate inflation, whereas the finance ministry is responsible for the fiscal policy and ensure high growth rate and the employment. The tension between RBI and central government is strengthened through these four instances. The first irritation is caused when the Allahabad High Court suggested the central government to use the Section 7, Clause 1 of RBI Act. Secondly, the government is in need of RBI surplus, but the RBI is stating that the surplus is very much important to maintain stability. Thirdly, the prompt corrective actions are curtailing the liquidity of the banks, which is making the economy rigid. Fourthly, the RBI directed the non-banking financial companies to go in search of other financial options for the liquidity crisis. There is a demand for easing the strict Basel norms of RBI. And another instance is that the central government is demanding the RBI to ease its Basel norms. We should know what is Section 7, Clause 1 of RBI Act, in which the government is having power to give directions to the RBI only when there is public interest involved. When the difference between the RBI and central government continues, two actions will take place. One is either the governor resigns or the central government removes the governor. If either one of this takes place, the financial market would become disastrous. It is a relief that we are nowhere near such a disaster. The only solution is that the Ministry of Finance and the RBI should seek compromises and ease the tension. Next is what happens when judges legislate. The major salient feature of our constitution is that independent judiciary and sovereign legislature. Even though our constitution clearly states about the salient feature, there is a question raised that is judicial discipline being observed? Why this question has been raised? Neither is the broad separation of powers among three organs of the state maintained, nor is the law clear. In these three cases, Supreme Court clearly stated that there is a clear line of separation between the judiciary and legislature. The first is Ram Javaiya versus State of Punjab, Union of India versus Deoki Nandan Agarwal. Third one is Suresh Seth versus Commissioner Indore Municipal Corporation. But these recent decisions of Supreme Court is proving the previous statement wrong. First is Arun Gopal versus Union of India, in which the Supreme Court fixed the timing for busting crackers. Next is MC Mehta versus Union of India, in which the Supreme Court directed that no BS4 vehicle should be used, instead BS6 vehicles can be sold. Next is Subhash Kashinath Mahajan versus State of Maharashtra, which diluted the Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocities Act 1989. Next is Rajesh Sharma versus State of Uttar Pradesh case, in which the Supreme Court included a new provision called Family Welfare Committee, which is not present in Section 498A. Not only the Supreme Court, recently National Green Tribunal ordered that petrol vehicles which is more than 15 year old and diesel vehicles which is more than 10 year old should not be used in Delhi. So what is the way forward is that both the judiciary and the legislature should clearly know their limits of function to maintain stability, thus maintaining the separation of power. The final topic of today is that another orbit on GSAT-29 launch. ISRO has marked a big milestone by launching an advanced communication satellite GSAT-29 through a heavy lift launcher GSLV Mark III. This 3,423 kilogram satellite took off from the launch pad at Satish Dhawan Space Center at Sriharikota. We are very proud about this satellite launch mission because this is the heaviest satellite launched from Indian soil. We should know about the satellite launch vehicle GSLV Mk3. This launcher is capable of carrying up to 10 tons to a lower Earth orbit and up to 4 tons to the geosynchronous transfer orbit. This satellite launch vehicle is completely designed in India and it is having 3 stages of fuel, which is solid, liquid and cryogenic. So in 2019, ISRO has planned for a Chandrayaan 2 moon mission program, which is a manned space mission program for which GSLV Mark 3 is planned to be used. GSAT-29 is a multi-beam, multi-band communication satellite which is used to give connectivity to users in the hilly and geographically inaccessible areas like Jammu Kashmir and northeastern regions of India. This is a heaviest satellite and has joined as the 33rd communication satellite built by ISRO. This mission life is 10 years and it is placed in the geostationary transfer orbit. This carries a GEO high resolution camera to aid in high resolution imaging. For the first time, we have used an optical communication payload which is utilized for data transmission at a very high rate. By successful launch of GSAT-29 through GSLV Mark 3, we have restored the morale at ISRO. Thank you.